way they got it, at the age they got it, that's because of open source. Okay, so let's be a little more concrete here. What experience will you get by contributing to an open source project? Well, if you contribute to an open source project, you're probably going to end up writing some code. And your code will be critiqued at length by someone who has a lot more experience than you. This is all incredibly valuable advice and experience that they are sharing with you for free. I can't tell you how much better my code is now as a result of 10 years of developing that source code and having it reviewed by other people in the industry who are experts in their field. You're also going to get a very good education experience by doing this coding in the open. You can't hide your little secrets. You can't take a little shortcut because every shortcut can be seen by everyone. And if you take a shortcut, you're going to get caught out. Which means that when you start running software, you stop developing shortcuts by default. Which means that when you get into industry practice, you've got good practices to start with. You don't cut your habit, the way you've learned to write code, just to write code the right way. Even if you're only a beginner, you can also offer a lot from the other side doing the reviews. Great authors are also great readers. Similarly, good software engineers should read other people's code regularly. Sometimes you'll learn a new trick. Sometimes you'll identify a pattern of behavior. You'll be able to investigate why that particular pattern of behavior is common. You can perform deep reviews of other people's code and in doing so, improve your own. Having to understand other people's code helps you understand that a programming language is a communications mechanism. And that's a key point. It's not just about code. Any non-trivial project also has a human communication overhead. You, in the industrial industry, you need to deal with customers, you need to deal with co-workers, you need to be able to hold an intelligent and astute design discussion, bring a conflict or a disagreement to resolution. These are all key skills that you have to be successful in industry, and you have to be able to be successful in open source. The only way to get them is to practice. There are also some intangible things that you can only really pick up by practice, like design taste. Who here knows what a singleton is? Right, who thinks they're a good idea? That's very good, okay, your education has shown you very well. When I went through, singletons were being taught as this is something you do in industry. It took me about 2 years of being in industry to realize that the answer is no, you do not ever do a singleton. And I learned that the hard way. Sometimes deliberately choosing a singleton, sometimes accidentally writing a singleton. Wisdom is not making the same mistake twice. But to get the wisdom, you need to make the mistakes in the first place, which means you have to have experience. Okay, so how do you get involved? Well, every project is a little bit different. We heard this morning about the Linux contribution process, but the broad strokes that are common across almost every open source project, it's only the minor details that are really going to change. First thing you're going to do, pick a project that is interesting to you. Pick something that you think has commercial relevance or potential, solves an actual problem out there in the real world. Pick something that appears to be emerging technology, see if you can hook your bandwagon to back that technology. Resist the temptation to start your own project. I'm sure you've got great ideas. That's not what you need at this point. You need the feedback of a larger community of experienced individuals showing you how to write code and how to participate in communities in a better way. Also, well-intentioned 20-year-olds who have been reinventing wheels, that the old guys pulled out 20 years ago, you've been there, you've done that, you've got the t-shirt, you know why it's a bad idea. Sometimes, very occasionally, the 20-year-old comes up with some wonderful new spin on the problem, but not normal. Okay, so you pick the project you want to contribute to. Well, what you do next, you learn how to use it. You can run through the tutorials, try to build your own X, where X is whatever the tool does. If you're looking to contribute to Django, build a website. Just like running your own project is a bad idea, jumping in and offering to help when you don't actually know what help looks like yet, that's a bad idea. So, find out how the community operates. How do they track bugs? What conventions exist for version control, for code formatting? Where do newbies go for help? Where does the design discussion around new ideas happen? Look for a little bit before you jump in. Good projects, mature projects, will have documented these conventions. And if these conventions haven't been documented, well, offer to document them for the community. Do the research and make that your first contribution. Every community, though, is different, and culture and tone matter. Get to understand community norms before you start. If you're going to a party where you don't know people, you don't just barge in and start doing performance art in the middle of the lounge room. You look for a bit. You see who else is there. You see how they behave. You introduce yourself to a few people. You edge yourself in. Then you do the public art performance in life. This is also a two-way street, though. When you're evaluating the project that you want to join, pay attention to warning signals in that community. When you get involved with open source, you are joining a community, a group of people that you're going to be spending a lot of time working with. And when you're picking a community to join, you should pay attention to the community that you're joining and make sure it's a community that is worth your time. You're going to be volunteering your time to help make this project better. So make sure that project is worth your time. Does the community have a code of conduct? More importantly, do they enforce that code of conduct, or do they just give it lip service? Does the core team exhibit behavior that deserves to be emulated? Are they nice people who encourage other people to be nice, or are they regularly bastards to everybody who they don't agree with? This makes a difference, and it's going to make a big difference to how you progress through the project as well. Once you've got to know the environment, next step is to start contributing, and your first contributions should be small. If you want to write code, try to fix a small problem first. Try answering the questions of newcomers on the mailing list. It's a fantastic way to practice your written communication skills, and it's also a fantastic way to prove to the people who have been around the project for a while that you know what you're talking about, that you've got your fundamentals all set all squared away. If you want to start writing code, try fixing a small bug. Something cosmetic and annoying, not actually something that's critical to system operation. And take that bug, run it all the way through to completion. Get it all the way till it is actually committed in code. You're probably not going to get immediate feedback. These are very large projects with lots of people doing the same thing. You're one of multiple people contributing, and so far you haven't done anything to make yourself stand out from the rest. So you're probably going to need to be a little bit politely consistent. Maybe start working on a second and a third issue in the same space to kind of prove that you're serious and you're not just kicking the tires. If you don't get a response, try asking someone who's well-known in the community, ask them just privately, hey, is there something here I could be doing better, or some different way I should approach this? Is there a reason this isn't progressing? Keep plugging away. Resist, at all costs, the temptation to start large. It's very, very easy to fall into the trap of saying, oh, I know, I'll write this big feature for this project and I'll make a name for myself in one foul swoop. In Django, big ideas that get proposed like this are referred to as ponies. Why? Because everyone wants a pony, so they take a lot of effort to look after them. So we're not going to just buy you one. Sometimes a pony is just a simple bug fix, sometimes it's a minor feature, sometimes it's a major feature or a massive refactoring of existing features. The point of calling something a pony is that, unfortunately, we can't satisfy everybody. Calling it a pony request is just one way of politely telling you no. Yeah, we like the idea, it might happen, but you've got to make it happen too. You've got to put in the effort to make this happen. It's not just going to magically land. Now, stop asking, help contribute, and see if we can make it happen. Now, some of those ideas come from people that are very, very well-meaning. Most of them come from people who are well-meaning. There are very few genuine trolls hanging around. But some of them really are just non-starters. Some ponies keep coming back, even though we've sent them to the naughty corner over and over and over again. Understanding why some ideas get rejected is an important part of the open source contribution process. And more broadly, it's an important part of just dealing with large teams and legacy code bases. Now again, I'm going to probably draw on a lot of Django examples in the coming slides, but this isn't a Django-specific thing. What I'm going to show you here is to show you the design decision process from the other side of the fence, from someone who's part of a mature project and someone who's a contributor, a senior contributor on open source projects, to see what it looks like from our side of the fence with people coming at us with suggestions. Why a project lead might say no to your idea in a way, and why that no might not make sense to you, but makes perfect sense to us. And again, a lot of what I'm saying here is just as true in industry as it is in open source. You're just learning your lessons in public when you do it. Now, say whether something is a pony request or not, this is a hard and fast set of rules. To some extent, it's a little bit like porn. You know it when you see it. But that isn't a very helpful definition. So here's a working definition. A bad pony is either something that's just plain wrong, it's something that's impractical. It's something that isn't a good fit for Django's design or whatever project it is you're contributing to. It's something that takes the project in the wrong direction, or it comes without an offer of assistance. Now, what you notice here is the first three of those are technical distinctions. The idea is technically wrong or incompatible in some way. Fourth is a project management issue, and the last one is a resource management issue. Okay, so first off, ideas that are just plain wrong. The first one, there is easy. There are ideas that just fail on a simple technical level. This idea violates a standard or best practice. This idea just can't be implemented. It would be a fantastic idea if only gravity pulled upwards. Anyone here heard of Rusty Russell? There's one, two, three. All right, so Rusty Russell's a Linux kernel hacker. A few years ago, he wrote a document where he referred to it. Catalog this list of things called the Rusty Russell interface level. It's basically a way of cataloging how complex a user interface is. A Rusty Russell level 1 interface is an interface that is impossible to get wrong. You don't even need to read the documentation. If you know it exists, you'll use it right. A Rusty Russell level 18 API is one that is impossible to get right, even if you've read the documentation. Guess which end of the scale you want your APIs to be at. Ideas can also violate something called DRY. DRY is an acronym that stands for don't repeat yourself. It's an underlying idea in software engineering that if you've got a core idea, you should only express that core idea once. You shouldn't have to write the same core idea in four different configuration files, four different source files, to make something happen. Now that doesn't mean you won't ever type the same code twice or the same string twice, but it means that the core idea is expressed once in the right place and is then utilized. Now, I won't give too many examples here because these are the ones that are easy to spot. They don't usually cause much debate because they're just wrong and they stand out as soon as someone points out that, no, that doesn't work, gravity doesn't work that way. What about impractical ideas? Now, these are the ones that aren't obviously wrong on first inspection, but they are still not really a good idea. They're not really wrong, but they're not really right either. You're designing for flexibility where no flexibility is actually required. Called yagging, you ain't gonna need it. There might be someone who needs that particular feature, but that doesn't mean you should structure your entire API to support that use case. You can also be changing the design contract of the project. If a project has been around for a while, users will have a bunch of implicit assumptions about how things work or how things should work. If you're changing those fundamentals, what you're gonna get is frustrated users. So a proposal might be a fantastic idea if only you're starting from a clean slate, but from an established project's point of view, that's changing the way that everybody expects this code to run. If what you're proposing is a small part of a much bigger problem, you might find yourself, your ideas getting rejected. In the early days of Django, we had a lot of bugs we discovered in one particular area of our database query API. We rejected a lot of patches that fixed one or two of those problems. Because what we really needed to do was stop focusing on the little problems and fix the big problem. We didn't just want to put band-aids over the great big crack in the damn wall. We wanted to rebuild the damn wall to make sure the whole thing didn't collapse on us. So if your suggestion or you're asking people to expend effort when we know that's a problem, there's also these thousand other problems, and the thousand other problems we haven't discovered yet. In asking people to help you fix this problem when this is the real problem, is going to make people frustrated dealing with it. There's also architecture astronauting, looking for something that is actually a problem, but step back to make sure that problem isn't part of something bigger. But you've got to have a little bit of perspective, but not too much perspective. Tim Minchin, the West Australian comic, he's got a comedy at one point saying, if you open up your mind too much, your brain will fall out. It's really easy to come up with a theoretical model, but unless that theoretical model actually renders into practicality, you're probably going to find your idea get rejected. Third idea, design mismatches. These are ideas that are technically fine in and of themselves. They're just not right for this project or this product. If you've got a big project, it's probably got a bunch of internal components. Proposals to replace one of those components with something completely new, especially if it's the buzzword du jour, is not going to get much traction with the core team. You're free to disagree with the choice of the parts that we've used, but you might even get us to concede some small improvements and adopt the best properties of this thing that you're proposing into the parts that we've got. But you're not going to convince us that our fundamental idea that we started with is wrong. This argument essentially boils down to, I love Django, and it'd be really great if only it was completely different. Changes of this nature do happen, but when they happen, They happen because someone, or more likely a group of people with long-term experience in the project, start to see a bit of a movement in the whole in the industry as a whole. And the movement comes from within the project, not from without. Similarly, proposals that ignore the underlying reason for design decisions will also tend to get short shrift. Django has made, over time, some very specific architectural choices. Django's database layer is not SQL. We have a function called aggregate. We don't have the ability to say group by. There is a reason for this, and it's important that you understand that reason. Django's template language is very deliberately not a programming language. There is a reason for this. Django is a server-side framework. We don't dictate anything client-side. There is a reason for this. Proposing to change these fundamentals, again, means you're not going to get traction within the community of your ideas. Common core, when people hit things like this, to say, well, why don't you just add a setting to control the feature? You can ask the end user to make a decision to whether they turn it on or off. A setting is not the solution. A setting is the problem. Every configuration that involves a setting, or every configuration is something that can go wrong. If a configuration needs to be tested, a configuration needs to be understood by end users. Simplicity is, at some level, a virtue. Interaction of these various parts can also be a problem. Behavior-modifying settings require app developers to either force users to similar settings or implement workarounds for when they discover a setting that wasn't what they expected. Here is the service to contact when you need to do X. That's a perfectly acceptable setting. Behavior changing as a result of the value of X, that's a bad idea. And if you don't believe me, look up a blog post called PHP, a Fractal of Bad Design. Because PHP has a bunch of these problems baked in and shows you canonically why it is a dumb idea to do it. Backwards compatibility also counts. It's something that you need to take into account when you're proposing an idea. Now, this very much varies between projects. Some projects, like Django, have a very rigorous backwards compatibility policy. Others don't. Which one is right for you depends upon your needs. If you spend your life working on short-term contracts, delivering sites with no long-term maintenance overhead, say promotional websites for advertising events, or supporting advertising campaigns, you don't have long-term problems. You finish your job, you move on to the next one. Every time you start again, you're free to start from scratch, start from new, replace something that didn't work so well last time, experiment with something this time around. You're looking at through the world through glasses that think of a 6 months as a really long time. However, if you're engaged in a multi-year project, you really, really care about long-term maintainability. In my former life working as a defense consultant, I was involved with the Joint Strike Fighter project, F-35 Lightning II, which is a multi-billion dollar project to develop the next generation tactical fighter for the Air Force, the US and allies. At the point the project was conceived in 1990, it didn't anticipate delivering a working airframe for 20 years, and it's late in delivering that airframe. And before it became operational, they were planning on doing two full rebuilds of the avionics subsystems. If you're in this space, you really care about long-term maintenance. You don't want the world shifting around an every 3 months. You can't use a project that doesn't have a 10-year support plan in place. And if you don't believe me that this is real and not just something in defense, ask the guys from Red Hat about their dealings with the New York Stock Exchange. They've got products that are moving out of life that are 10, 15 years old. They, for the love of God, want to stop supporting. The New York Stock Exchange is throwing gobs of money at them because they don't want to change. Because changing the New York Stock Exchange is a big deal. Now, this isn't a matter of being right or wrong. They're solving different problems. But the project as a whole will have made the decision about what side of the fence they deal with. Django, we're on the backwards compatibility focus side. Ruby on Rails, for example, tends to be on the other side. They move agile and break things. Not one's right, one's wrong. They're right and wrong for different applications. You need to understand what the project's philosophy is. Fourth idea is wrong ideas. Ideas that are sound and match the project, but still aren't really appropriate for the project core. The important distinction here is that I'm talking about the core project, not the broader community. Community is a whole other kettle of fish. One manifestation of this is feature creep, trying to extend a project and to turn it into something that it just isn't. Django is not a web server. Stop trying to turn it into one, because we're never going to do it. Apache is a web server. It's a really good one. There's lots of other alternatives if you want to use a different web server. Use them. Make them web servers. They already are. tangos in the database. If you want connection pooling, use a connection pooler. There are really good ones out there. When someone comes to a project like Django and says, hey, why don't you add X into your project, into the core of your project? That may be what you're saying. Why don't you add X to core? What we hear on the other side of the fence is, here's something else for you to worry about. Hey, wouldn't you look after this for me? The core team of an open source project has limited resources. Every component we add to the core is something else we need to maintain. If you double the number of lines of code, then each line of code gets half as much attention from the same number of people. Adding features to code could actually reduce project quality. It will certainly extend timelines, just simply due to testing overhead, and it will definitely increase bugs just through sheer source line of code count. The only way in which the core, or something adding something to core, acts as a quality guarantee is from the self-user perspective. The core is good at choosing good things. If core picks this, it must be good. That doesn't make it any better than it already is. It just means that someone's pointing at it and saying it's good. This is a community. Open source is all about community. The core, in any given language project community, is the first amongst equals because it's the hub around everything which everything else revolves. We, the Django core team, control Django's core, but we don't have to control everything else. In fact, the Django community is trying to do the exact opposite, to push things out of core into the community. Why? Because we're looking to develop an ecosystem, not just improve Django as a tool. To explain this, I'd like to take a quick tangent here and talk about tractors. One of the project founders of Django is a man named Jacob Kaplan-Moss. Jacob is a man of many talents, but his real passion is his farm and his tractor called Tinkerbell. As well as being a great source of farming stories, it's also a very interesting source for analogies. One of the interesting features of farm tractors is something called the three-point linkage. It's a system that's been in use on tractors for something like 90 years. It was originally developed in the 1920s by Ferguson Tractors in the UK, and then adopted by pretty much every farming company in the world. Eventually codified as an ISO standard, really just codifying what everyone was already doing. What the three-point linkage does is provide a very simple interface that enables a tractor to be hooked up to a plow, seeder, harvester, whatever else you've got. And hitting the backwards compatibility point, it's been a consistent interface since the 1920s. A farm tool built in the 30s will connect to a tractor that came off the assembly line this week, and vice versa. What the three-point linkage does is change a tractor from being a single-purpose tool into being part of an ecosystem. When you buy a tool, you get a tool, and you can buy a really fine set of tools. But the real power comes when those tools get to work together. When you buy into an ecosystem, you get infinitely more value because you're buying into all the ways the tools can interact with each other. This is really just Metcalfe's law writ large. Metcalfe's law says that the mobility of a network, or the utility of a network, increases with the square of its participants. Django by itself is interesting. It can do stuff, but it has limits. What's exciting is the ecosystem of bits around the outside of Django that lets you do things. Every time someone writes a plugin or a library or an extension that's part of the Django ecosystem, every other package gains value because it's something that's compatible with all the other bits. There's almost 4,000 packages on PyPI that are tagged Django. Even if you consider Sturgeon's law that 90% of everything is crap, that's still 400 useful packages that you can engage and use. It's also important to know your audience. Common refrain on the Django mailing list is that when rejecting features, to say that Django is a 90% framework. It doesn't expect that it's going to get to solve every problem, but it should try to make 90% of websites easy to build. That means there's 10% of problems we're deliberately not trying to solve. So where do you draw the line? Do you make the framework easy to use for everybody? Or do you try to extend it to for most people? Or do you try to satisfy everybody by making an API usable for every possible use case? Cal Henderson, in his keynote at the very, very first DjangoCon, made the very astute observation that 99% of websites are not in the top 1% of websites by traffic. Think about that for a moment. For the vast majority of projects, engineering time is much more costly than server time. Picking your projects, building your projects around flexibility and complete extensibility, when frankly being opinionated and logging off the 10% use case, is probably going to be a much better option and much easier to use. If you are genuinely targeting that 10%, that's fine. But it's a conscious choice. And you'll probably find that by servicing that 10%, your project isn't suitable for the 90% piece. Lastly, there's the non-technical reasons. Here's a big job and I'd like someone else to do it, occasionally accompanied by please. I think Django should write more blog posts. I think we should have a weekly news summary. I think we should have a monthly tarball download. I think we should have a continuous build. We should have pre-compiled PDF documentation. These are all great ideas. They all take time. An hour spent building a PDF documentation builder is an hour that I even spend reviewing designs on Django developers, or answering questions on Django users, or fixing bugs. There is a limit to my time. When something can be done by someone outside the core team, it should be. And the community as a whole is better for it. If you think there's a need for a weekly roundup, great, write one. Build it and they will come. There's a difference here between the core and the community. The core doesn't have to be everything. Okay, so if you do actually genuinely have a pull request, some big feature that you want to get in, what do you do now? No one disagrees these ideas are valuable, assuming they don't hit one of the design problems I've described. There's a reason we haven't got them. They're not simple. We need your help to work with us, making things happen. Putting your name on the ticket as a CC, saying me too on a ticket, or a mailing list thread, posting a blog post which declares adamantly that there is absolutely no way that Django could be used for any serious website that didn't have feature X. Playing funny games with a ticket tracker, trying to make your ticket float up some list that's automatically generated. None of these things will help make your feature become real. The only one of them that's socially acceptable is the first one, putting your name on the ticket, and that basically just a, I'm a passive consumer of this technology and would like to be notified if this ever happens, answer. What will work? Offer to help out. Better still, actually help out. Build up karma in the community, do the unglamorous stuff, triage, do mailing lists, post feedback. You'll notice there's one obvious thing that is not on this list, writing code. The bigger the pony, the more important this guidance becomes. If you only want a little thing, a little tiny bug fix, a really minor feature, yeah, okay, sure, go write some code, put it out of its misery. This is the way you prove yourself to the community, by building trust. Demonstrate that you know how to write code, and how to write the test, and how to write docs, and everything else. Prove that you know what the process requires. It takes me 10 minutes to review a small patch. It takes me 10 minutes to review a big patch. If I trust the author, I'm invested in an idea, or I feel like I owe you. Ultimately, it's a matter of trust. The core team has limited resources. We need to make the best use of our time. Now, this may sound callous or rude, but it's sheer practicality. Ignoring people is the only way I get stuff done. I simply do not have enough hours in the day to answer every question on a mailing list, answer every question, every design discussion that comes up, triage every bug that gets reported. I need personally, and we as a team, as a core team, need to let some things go through to the keeper. And as soon as you do that, you've got to have a criteria for choosing who you pay attention to. Team players are my number one priority. I'm also going to make an admission here. I'm human. I like to help people who help me. If other members of the core team, Yannis Lydell, Alex Gaynor, they ask me for a review, I will move heaven and earth to make that happen for them. There are people that I will help if they are working in an area that is of strategic interest to me, that happens to align with my own personal interests. There are also people that I don't pay a lot of attention to. Either they're working in an area that just does not interest me, I mostly ignore internationalization issues for my sins. I try very, very hard to ignore my sequel. Or the person who's proposing the idea has worn out their karma with me. I literally cannot deal with you anymore. If you get to that place, don't be surprised that I don't answer your emails anymore. I'm willing to ignore you and give my attention to someone who's going to progress what I need to do. If you've ever used Git or GitHub, and you're professional software people, you need to learn how to use Git or GitHub, you'll know about forking, because it's the big button up there that says fork. It's the process by which you take a project repository, create a working copy you can do something with. A lot of open source messaging is about how it's really easy to fork a project. You need a patch applied, create a fork. Forks are easy to create. But the big technical advantage that Git and distributed version control introduced wasn't forking. It was merging. It was tracking, doing all the tracking, doing all the accounting, made it easy to bring contributions from people who had forked back into the trunk. And by solving the technical problem, it's now become a social problem. I need to decide what I'm going to merge. Open source projects try to evaluate every idea on its merits. However, access to the attention of the core team is also merit-based. And for individual contributors, different measures of merit may apply. I might be trying to meet a particular diversity goal. I may be trying to get a particular picture in the court. I may be just trying to push my own barrow and make myself look good. It's entirely up to the core teams to what that merit looks like. Spanning the two between the technical merit of your idea and the merit of the person who's going to review your idea, or the intent of merit, attention of the merit of the attention of the person who's going to review your idea, that's the trick to open source contribution. And ultimately, is the trick to being able to contribute in any social activity. If you must propose a new idea, do the research. Demonstrate you understand the problem. An implementation trumps idle discussion every single time. Maximize the utility of the core team. The core team is the bottleneck in this whole process. Make it a no-brainer for the core team to help you. Lay everything out for them. If someone comes up and says, hey, what about this idea? Now I've got to work out what the idea is. I've got to track for all these mailings. If you come to me with a document that's a three-page summary of everything that's been said as a this idea, the good things, the bad things, this is who agrees, this is who disagrees, this is what I'm suggesting as the way forward, and here's a working implementation. Yeah, okay, you've just done a lot of my work for me. All I'm going to do is say yes, or no but, or whatever the answer happens to be. Maximize my utility, I'm going to start liking you, and I'll start paying attention to your name, and then you'll find a lot easier to get contributions through. Ask for forgiveness, not permission. As long as you're asking for forgiveness for a complete idea, not for some, you know, thing that violates one of the rules I talked about earlier. Do the hard and glamorous stuff. Everybody wants to fix the big bug, wants to land the big feature. Nobody ever wants to do the dirty work. Triaging bugs, writing and editing documentation, writing tutorials and screencasts, answering the dumb questions on the mailing list for the people who just keep coming. You can earn a lot of brownie points for the core team of any project by taking that crap off their desk. Because you're doing the scut work that they'd really rather not be doing. It's the stuff that has to be done, and because they're the core team, it ultimately falls down to them. But if you can take that off their desk, all of a sudden, you become a very, very attractive person. Eventually, if you keep at it, you will gain a reputation in the community. Marketing people like to talk about conversion funnels. It's helpful to think about contributing to open source in a simple sort of way. You start as a potential user, you become a user of the project, you participate more and more in the community until eventually you become a community leader. You might end up as a core developer, a member of the core team over time, but even if you don't, the beautiful thing about open source is that it isn't wasted effort. If you deal with a project on a public bug tracking system, you should be able to point at tickets and say, that's how I contributed. And you go back to an employer and say, that's what I did. And if it's a project that the employer uses on a day-to-day basis, you've just got yourself an in to make your resume stand out from everyone else. So, what's the catch? Well, the catch is there's no such thing as a free lunch. You need to put in the effort. Okay? This is all volunteer work. Unfortunately, at the moment, open source contribution is largely driven by volunteer efforts. And I appreciate that many people have external economic constraints that make it difficult to do this. But if you have the means, the opportunity is there for you. You can take hold of this with both hands and start your career with a rocket, getting international recognition for your skills. So, what have you got to lose? Here endeth the career advice. Open source has done wonders for my career. The only thing you risk is time. Worst case, you'll get some valuable software engineering experience. Best case, you'll send your career on an amazing fast track. But above all, it can be fun. Some people play Sudoku puzzles in their spare time. I fix Django. Or tinker on UIs on mobile phones. There's an amazing community of people working around open source projects. And that's true of every open source community. Working on open source tastes good and it's good for you. And if you're looking for something to work on, come talk to me. I've got plenty of yaks and I need lots of help shaving them. In particular, if you make the first steps towards shaving a yak in October, there is a free t-shirt in it for you. If you register on the Hacktoberfest website and submit 4 pull requests to any open source project in the month of October, the lovely people at GitHub and DigitalOcean will send you a free t-shirt. I've got plenty of brand spanking new yaks that I can give you 4 easily. Come see me. As the Dr. Kazoos book says, kids, you can move mountains, but only at 3/4% guarantee. And in 10 years' time, maybe you'll be the one up here on the stage extolling the virtues of open source to the next generation. Thank you very much.